Yes, good morning everyone. So with respect to our last class, we have come across with our fourth module, as we had come across with these things, like it was how to identify which user has logged in, or else how a process accounting can be done. Okay, so what are the respective argument values which it possesses across. Okay, so these all things we have come across with our last classes. So let us come across in today's class with this new section, and that is wherein we start across with IPC, that is inter-process communication. So firstly, let us get across to know what is this inter-process communication. So inter-process communication is a one where the communication is across between the processes there. Okay, so when a process wants to communicate with another process, so those processes can be a child and a parent, or else two individual peered process, or else anything. So how can we have an communication between them? Okay, what are the ways of communication across the processes? So these are the things what we are dealing across in this particular section there. So in that, the very first one which you are coming across with one of the medium for your inter-process communication is pipes. Okay, so we have this particular symbol also we have come across in Unix and shell programming already. Okay, and this symbol is just above your enter key and below the backspace key. Okay, so that's an I'll just show you across. Okay, so this is an pipeline symbol which we are usually using across. Okay, so if I use any particular command here and one more command over here, so what will your pipeline do is, so whatever is there onto your left hand side, okay, so it need not be saved across in any particular file on a disk or anything. So what will happen, the output of this particular command will act as an input for this command whatever is there on the right side. So this working atmosphere or this working thing is being created by this pipeline. Okay, so this pipeline treats the process onto the left hand side as a reader process, and the one which is over here, okay, onto the right hand side is treated as a writer process there. Okay, so here you can just come across, it says that pipes are the oldest form of IPC, that is inter-process communication. Okay, so it has two particular limitations there. Okay, so one limitation is, it says that they have been half duplex. Okay, half duplex says that data flows in only one direction. Okay, so here the data is flowing across in only one direction there. Okay, you are not having and return back anything. Okay, so this we call across as a limitation of a pipe. Okay, so pipes can be used only between the processes that have a common ancestor. Normally a pipe is created by a process, that process calls fork, okay, and the pipe is used between the parent and the child process. Okay, how a pipe can be created is, you can create a pipe using this particular API. Okay, so what is this API? It's with unistd.h as a header file, pipe. Okay, so it takes two respective entries, okay, that is file des of two, that is file descriptor 0, file descriptor 1. Okay, so it has two respective entries across on a file descriptor there. Okay, so that happens to be your input for the pipe there. Okay, so 0 acts across as your open for reading, that's a reader process, and one more for 1 which I am speaking across, so that has been opened across for a writing. Okay, so keep in mind, whenever I am speaking about this pipeline or as a pipe as an inter-process communication, so it is something like an online communication. So both of the processes should be there, only then a pipeline can execute normally. So if at all either of one is missing, so at that time we cannot say, or else we cannot say out that particular process will not happen there. Okay, so two file descriptors are returned through the respective file des as an argument. Okay, so this file des as an argument is file des of 0 is open, okay, for reading, and file des of 1 is open for writing there. Okay, so wherein just now I said you across as a reader and a writer process, so onto the left hand side whatever is there, it is for reading. Okay, and onto the right hand side whatever is there, that's for the writing there. Okay, the output of file des of 1 is the input for file des of 0. Okay, so this is one. So here you can come across two ways of view of a half duplex pipe there. Okay, only in a single user process you can have a FD of 0 and FD of 1, or else you can have an user process and a pipeline can be created through the kernel. It can be viewed in two ways, either like this it can view, or else you can view it as a kernel prepares as a pipe, and through that pipe you have FD 0 and from FD 1 it has been written. Okay, so half duplex pipe after a fork, what happens there actually? So whenever I'm speaking across with a fork as a term, always keep in mind a parent and a child process comes into existence there. Okay, a parent has FD of 0, FD of 1. Okay, so FD of 0 is been taken across as a read there. Okay, there is a fork which has happened across. Okay, from there it has been read across. Okay, now we can just see that parent process is using this pipe and reading from FD of 0, okay, whereas it is writing using FD of 1. Okay, whereas what is child process doing? It is reading through FD of 0 through the same pipe, and through the same pipe it is writing using FD of 1. Okay, so this is with your half duplex pipe after a fork there. Okay, so this is one. Then pipe from parent to the child. Okay, so wherein I have a pipe as an thing from a parent to the child. So wherein I have from one particular process, that is to the parent as a process, I have FD1. Okay, whereas it is a writer process. So whereas FD0 is wherein you are reading from this particular process there. Okay, that's a child process. Okay, so that is with across with your pipe there. Okay, then followed out, let us come across with the two more. Okay, other respective things which are used across as your inter-process communication. So what are those? One is called out as P open, and one more is called out as P close. Okay, so P open is nothing but where you are creating, or else where you are opening up a pipe for your reading purpose there. Okay, so you can just come across, since a common operation is to create a pipe to another process to either read its output or send its input there. Okay, the standard input output library has historically been provided using P open and P close. Okay, so you can just come across here. There are two things which has been handled by your pipe there. Okay, so and here you can see that it's with a return type of file. So that's nothing but it returns the termination status of what has been executed there. Okay, else one on error there. Okay, what has to be executed? The function popen does a fork and exec of this execute of this command string and returns a standard input output file pointer there. Okay, if this type is R, the file pointer is connected to the standard output of the command string. Okay, if it is W, then it is connected to the standard input there. Okay, so this is what happens across with your P open there. Okay, so it has been, now whenever I say a file pointer there, so it will be pointing across based on the type value. So if it is R, the file pointer is connected to the standard output there, because now it has read, it has to return back, it has to write down something. Okay, so the same way we have one more terminologies which we can use, and that's called as coprocessors. So what do you mean by coprocessors there? So coprocessors is nothing but when the same program generates the filter's input and reads the filter's output there. Okay, when you are using two pipes there. Okay, pipe 1 and pipe 2. Okay, so and when I'm driving a coforce by writing its standard input and reading its standard output there. Okay, you can just see that it's with the FD1. Of one, it's nothing but a standard input there. Okay, so it's been taken across from a pipeline. Okay, FD of 0 is across wherein you are reading through one more pipeline. Okay, so this is called out as coprocessors. I have two different processes through which the respective communication is being happening there. Okay, so one more is a part of your respective process there. Okay, that's with inter-process communication, and that's called out as FIFO. Okay, we have come across with FIFO as a file type in our very first class when we were telling regarding different types of files there. So there is a FIFO file. So for this FIFO, we take first one is a path name, and the second one is in which, using which mode are you creating it. Okay, so FIFO, or else it can be pipe. So of course FIFO is a normal regular file itself. Okay, but it has a very special type of feasibility, that which it says that both the reader and the writer processor should be active. Okay, so this make FIFO file, or else any FIFO file, will not capture any disk space there. Okay, So here, if the mode, okay, so whatever you have specified as a mode as an argument in open, create, the same lies here also, okay. If O underscore non block is specified, an open for read only returns immediately, okay, but an open for write only returns one with error number setting across as there is no, because if at all there either of the one, either reader process or writer process is absent, so it returns back with an error there, okay. In the normal case, okay, if O underscore non block is not specified and open for read only blocks until some other process opens the FIFO for writing there, okay. Since we have used make FIFO to create a FIFO, we open it using open there, okay. That is with across with your FIFO, so it returns back 0 on success and 1 on error there, okay. Let us come across with one more type of an inter-process communication, and that's called as message queue. Okay, message queue is nothing but, I hope so everyone is aware with this term called as linked list. Okay, so message queue is a linked list of messages stored within the kernel and the identified by a message queue identifier. Okay, we will call the message queue just a queue and its identifier a queue ID. Okay, so message are being enrolled in a queue format, okay, and every queue is been identified by a queue ID there, okay. So it accesses through this particular structure called out as msqid_ds. So what is this? It's with certain things here, okay, which I'll be telling across one by one. ipc_perm, it is the one data type which is struct ipc_perm. It is for this message permission there, okay. So need not worry now, because this is an advanced view towards the things where it will be used across in your network communication there, okay. And as per your syllabus or something, now we are not coming across with that particular thing. Just keep in mind that this is one of the this is one of the variable which has been enrolled in this particular structure there, okay. The second one is, it tells you regarding the number of messages, okay, how many number of messages are there. Now if at all I am speaking about a linked list, so how many number of messages are there, so it tells you like 4 messages or 5 messages, okay, that has been identified by this, okay. msg_qbytes will tell you maximum number of bytes on the queue, okay, what is the length of each of the message there, okay. Then comes msg_lspid, so that is the PID of last message sent, okay, which has sent the last message, so that PID will be given to you. Last message received, so the next one is PID of the last message which has been received there, okay. Then we are having three respective variables there, okay, which will tell you msg_stype will tell you last message sent time there, r time will tell you last message received time, and C time will tell you last change time, okay. So these are the respective things which will be given across for each of the identified messages across in a message queue, okay. So how can I have operations with this particular structure, or else how can I have the operations with a message queue there? So you can have it through using this particular API that's called out as msg_get, okay. So this is a header file which is included, okay, and this header file has this particular structure there, okay. So msg_get, so it takes the very first argument is a key, okay, and the second one is flag, okay. So what is key now? Key is nothing but the message key there, okay. It returns the get is nothing but is either you are opening an existing queue or else you are creating a new queue by using this, okay. So when a new queue is created, the following members of the message queue ID DS structure are initialized, okay. IPC PERM structure is initialized, the mode member of the structure is set to the corresponding permission of the bit flags, okay. This happens if at all you have a key with you, and with what flag are you going to open it. So at that time it acts differently. Now in the other way, it is I am explaining you regarding with when and creation of a queue has been done, okay. This is the one. The second one is msg queue num, these all things, okay, whatever are your other one, these all are being assigned to, are being set to 0. msg c time is set to the current time, then MSG cubites is set to the system limit, whatever is your system limit. On success, MSG get returns a non-negative message queue ID. This value is then used with other three message queue functions further whenever you are using across. Okay. That's next particular API under this message queue is MSG CTL. Okay, this is a function which performs various operations on a queue. Okay, it returns back 0 on success and 1 on error. Okay, so what is this? MSG CTL is wherein you are controlling some of the aspects under your message queue there. Okay, it takes the very first one is message queue ID. The second one is command. Okay, and the third one is a structure type of a variable called as buff. Okay, so it is IPC underscore RMID. It removes the message queue MSQID and destroy the corresponding MSQID underscore DS. Okay, IPC underscore set, it set members of the MSQID underscore DS data structure from the buff. Okay, then IPC underscore stat, it copy members of the MSQID data structure into the buff. Okay, so these are the values which can be replaced by the command there. Okay, so it is something like a controlling operations across on your message queue ID as per your requirement there. Okay, this returns 0 on success if everything has been set appropriately. Okay, else it returns 1 on error. Okay, this is one. The next one is send. Whenever a process is sending anything, so at that time MSG send, okay, MSQID is the first argument, then the second one is PTR, that's with constant void PTR, and the third one is how many number of bytes are you going to send and the flag. Okay, here you can just come across each message, okay, is composed of a positive long integer field, a non-negative length n bytes there. What is the length? Okay, what's the actual data byte size there? Messages are always placed at the end of the queue. The PTR argument is nothing but it points to the long integer that contains a positive integer message type, and it is immediately followed by the message data. There is no message data if n bytes is 0. Okay, if the largest message we send is 512 bytes, then we can define this particular structure, okay, called out as mymess. Okay, what is this mymessage there? Mymessage holds you two respective data with it. Okay, one is m type and one more is m text there. Okay, m type tells you what is the length or else how long will you be requiring across with your message there, and mtext will be actually holding the data there, what message are you looking across. Okay, and this pointer, whatever is there as your second argument, okay, this is a argument which will be pointing to this particular structure type of variable called as my message there. Okay, so you can just go across. The message type can be used by the receiver to fetch the messages in an order other than first in and first out there. Okay, so this is with the things that, okay, here you are coming across with sending up of message. Whenever you are sending a message, these are the things what you have to consider there. Okay, then messages are retrieved from a queue by message RCV. Okay, message RCV is used for holding the messages. Okay, what does it return back? It returns back, you can just see here, it returns back size underscore t. Size underscore t is size of the data portion of message if okay or one on error. The type argument let us specify which message we want. Okay, which message we want here. So here you can just see here what is this API MSG RCV. Okay, it takes the argument as MSQID, void PTR, size underscore t, n bytes, what's the how many number of bytes, then the long type, okay, then flag value. Okay, so here comes type as an argument here. Flag, n bytes, PTR, MSQID are the same things whatever you are specified here. Okay, but apart from that, okay, so let us come across this flag value will tell you that whether are you receiving the things from the same respective queue or else are you looking across with some other respective entry there. Okay, so this is with your MSG RCV. Okay, here you can just see that there is an argument called out as type. So with this type as an argument, you are coming across with three values there. Type is equals to 0 if the type is specified greater than 0 or less than 0. If it's equals to 0, the first message on the queue is written. If it is greater than the 0, then what value will it be there? The first message on the queue whose message type equals the type is written there. Okay, and if at all it is less than 0, the first message on the queue whose message type is the lowest value less than or equal to the absolute value of the type is written there. Okay, so this is with your MSG RCV. Okay, and this is all with your inter-process communication there. Okay, so one more is there, that's called out as semaphore. Okay, which I'll tell you across in your next particular video there. Thank you.